Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to MySymbol.com and Memphis Drum Shop. And today, today's so special for us here. We are honored. We are honored and so pleased to have with us today the fabulous John Jabo Starks and Clyde Stubblefield.
Hit it now.
Yeah, that's what I like. I got a question for you.
Yes, sir.
And is this the first time you two gentlemen have ever played together before?
Yeah.
No.
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 Well, we're so glad to have you with us here today. Have you enjoyed your little trip at Memphis, Tennessee so far?
It's been beautiful.
Yes, well, thank you,
sir. Well, this is the drummer of my life. When I first met him, he's always been my drummer in my life. I don't try to play what he play, but I like his tones and the way he play drums. And I says that's my favorite drummer, and still is, amazingly.
That's good though. It's I gotta say this before we go too much further. You know, this is one of the most. It is the most complete and most beautiful music drum shop that I've ever been in.
Yes,
period.
It is.
I've been in a lot of them around the world, and this is the epitome of those. I mean,
this is.
You have really done something wonderful.
Thank you.
This is great. Fabulous.
Thank you for having us here, too.
We've got a lot of great guys who work here at Memphis Drum Shop, and they are all so pleased and proud that you're here today, too. So.
Thank you. Yeah, and you've been asked questions, too.
And to be playing minor cymbals and Yamaha drums is a fabulous thing for you, Jabo, and I.
Okay.
That is great. That's our drums and cymbals.
Well, how long have you been playing minor cymbals?
Oh, man.
About
I don't
six,
know.
7 years.
No, it's been a little longer than that, I believe.
Yeah.
I think it's been.
97. It's been about.
Since 97.
Since 97.
Since 97, yeah.
Okay.
Since 97.
Okay.
And, you know, and too, Jim, anyone that's listening to what we are doing, they can always go into mysymbol.com and get everything that we're playing too here.
Oh, that's right. True, too. That's true, too.
They can do that, yes.
And these cymbals are some of the greatest cymbals for us playing and getting the tone you want from them. You don't get good tone from other cymbals. You get a good tone from these cymbals.
I noticed Jabo said something yesterday about, you know, like you haven't heard cymbals like these since the set ones you had back in like 58 or when was it?
Back in 1950. Yeah, the last of 58, 59, I was playing a set of cymbals that were these cymbals at that time. But then I got, and that's the sound you love to hear, which I still have that set of cymbals. But when I heard these cymbals, I had to come from around the corner and ask who it was, and that just sold me, because these are the closest thing that I have ever had to the cymbals that I was playing. I don't like using other people's names and things, but I'm just saying the other cymbals that I was playing was nothing compared to these. You know, they were the closest thing to them.
We chose these the same time together. We chose these cymbals together.
Wow. Okay.
Because, you know, we never went alone on stuff. We always made decisions together for drum things. Yeah. And they were perfect. Everything has been perfect.
Well, I got to say, when it comes to drum team, there's two sitting right there that I really like. Hey, we got some questions I want to get to here. We actually got quite a few from around the world. And here's one. This is Jeffrey Lewis from Atlanta, Georgia. And he says, "Hi, Jabo. Can you tell us what it was like to play with B.B. King and how it was different than your time with James Brown?"
Okay. First, you must understand that I came out on the road. I started playing. Being from Mobile, I started playing the blues. That was the first thing. So the blues was always already instilled in me. But when I went with James Brown, that was a complete different way of playing. It was a different style of playing, put it that way, playing with James Brown. But when I went back to B.B. King and played with B.B. King, that was just like putting me back in a briar patch again. I went back to the roots that I came out of before I left, you know.
Well, let me ask you this question. Yes. See, like, when I go to play a James Brown song, I listen to you guys, and now I know how to play it. But when you went from B.B. King to James Brown, how did you know? Who did you listen to play like James Brown, which was different than B.B. King?
What you do is, when James Brown hired you, he hired you, he told you to stand on the side of the stage and watch the people he had up there playing anyway. So if you're musically minded, you watch those drummers, most basically you watch what he's doing, because what he's doing, you have to incorporate that with the music that they're playing. So it was not really that complicated, for me to play the way that I played. But what I heard when I heard him do that, that made me change some things that I was doing to go into playing that kind of a feel to play with.
Okay. Well, here's a question for Clyde. This is David McLaughlin from Dublin, Ireland.
Okay.
And he wants to know, how did you get your big break in drumming? And you know, what was the first thing that really brought you into drumming and got you to James Brown or whatever?
Well, I don't know what brought me into drumming. Well, U.S. marching band brought me into drumming. I left school one day to go downtown to hit a U.S. marching drum, and I never thought about playing drums, and I went back home going, that's the way I just went home marching and singing like that. And when I got home, I made me some drumsticks out of tree limbs and started playing on garbage can lids and pasteboard boxes. And that got me into playing drums. And that's the only thing I knew. I never took lessons. I don't know nothing about those. And a trumpet player and I finally got a school drummer. School drum, I mean, a big drum. And we sit on the back porch after school and play when the Saints go marching in. And I guess that's all I remember for playing drums. And I never got into a set until when I got with a band in Chattanooga. I tried to get a set of drums, but they cost too much and I didn't have the money. So I don't even know where I even got drums from or nothing. I just sit down and start playing, and that's what we done. And I loved it.
James Brown.
Well, when I got with James Brown, it was like I was living in Macon, Georgia then. And James and the club owner were good friends, and James told me, I was playing, and some guy came up and says, "When you get through, Mr. Brown want to talk to you back there." I didn't know James Brown. And I says, okay. And when we got through with that song, we started a nothing I started playing. I didn't pay it no attention going back talking to him. And while I was playing that song, Brown came up and says, hey, I want to talk to you when you finish playing. I says, cool. And I liked his attitude at that time. And when I got through playing, I went back and sat down and talked to him. He says, well, I want you to come and audition for me. And I says, good. And when can I do it? And he got with the club owner to get me down to Augusta, Georgia. And I went down to Augusta, Georgia to about 2 weeks. And that's when I met Jabo. I walked in the dressing room before I started auditioning, and I says, who are you? He says, I'm Jabo Starks. I says, oh. I said, who you play with before James? He says, I used to play with B.B. King. I said, B.B. King? Because he was my favorite drummer. He still is. And I could not believe that he was with James Brown. I'm going, if he's with James Brown, this has got to be something. It can't just be a band. It's got to be something. And it was something. I'm talking about it was a trip.
Yeah, very good. And Jabo, yesterday, I remember something you said yesterday, too, about how you watched James Brown from the time he came on the stage, you know, to the time he left. You had your eyes on him.
That's right.
And here's a question that says, did you ever miss a cue from James Brown? And if you did, what happened? So either one of you can
know,
answer that question.
You know, that's a good question. And before I really give the answer, I don't think I ever missed a cue, because it was a matter of being business wise with James Brown, because James Brown would fine you if you missed the cue. And I didn't pay fines, because you tell me what you want me to do the way you want me to do it.
He didn't pay anything.
Then I do that. But you know, he had a lot of the cues, a lot of the hits that James was doing. I started doing those hits. And so at times I've known him to come up, I guess with all the stuff in his mind. He has missed one or two. And he'll look back at you and laugh and say, you got me. And but then in the same tune, he'll turn around and come back and do it again so he could catch up with it. But I don't ever remember.
Did you fine him? Or did he pay a fine when he missed one?
Are you joking? That's the boss, man.
He played us against each other.
That was the boss, though.
And, you know, when some Jabo was playing something good and I knew he had it, Brown would turn around and tell me to play. And I go, why he want me to change up this song when Jabo was playing it? You know, no reason. He was playing us against each other.
Well, that's kind of like this next question that I got here. Why did James Brown have two drummers, and how was it decided which drummer played on which tune? You know,
he had. If you want me to, I can give you my answer for it. He had two drummers because, at one time, there was only one drummer, one bass player, one guitar player. And he was in the theater. And that rhythm section had planned on quitting. They had told him, given him options, you're either gonna give us a raise and back off, or we're gonna quit right here. At that time, the theater was packed with James people, so you know, with the crowd. So he was not about to give that away and give that up. So he went along with him that time. Mm-hmm. But he made this statement: I will never be caught with one rhythm player as long as I keep a band. So he had two drummers, two bass players, two guitar players. Mm-hmm. And it was one thing about James when you played with him, when you ask about, do you know when to play and when not to play? Uh-uh, we didn't play together. But you, as a drummer, or as in a rhythm section with Jane in the rhythm section, you had to know his entire show at all times. Well, and you had to pay attention to him at all times.
For some reason, he walked on stage when Jabo and I were sitting on stage with the group. He says, I got to get rid of one of these drummers. And Jabo and I looked at each other and go, cool. And I says, well, Mr. Brown, Jabbo's been with you longer. I'll leave. I was just saying that out of the blue, and he says, no, not you. And Jabo says, who, me? And he says, And he says, no, not you either. Then we go, this is when we learned him. And then we go, who is he talking about? Who is he talking about? You and I, he don't want to get rid of it. He says, well, I'll see y'all in a minute. He walked to his dressing room. And we still sitting there wondering, which drummer is he going to get rid of?
He kept you guessing. Well, we've got another question, but we have a phone call here I've got from Mr. Steve Jordan. He's called in. Steve, are you there?
And not too much, man. How you doing, Steve?
I'm doing great. Look, at this much, I know right now the room that you're in is the funkiest room on the planet.
He knows where you are. Steve has been in this room, and he said it's the funkiest room on the planet right now because you two are in here.
Well, when Jabo and I play, we play naturally. We don't try to copy no one else. We listen to other people, well, love them, but we don't try to copy those people. We play our own feeling, our own soul attack.
You know, Steve is asking, too. He wants to pick. He has a question. I know him. He has something he wants to know.
First of all, let me just say that I want to thank you for all the years of incredible playing that both of you have done. The two of you are major influences on my playing, and I know that you've been major influences on just a ton of people, not just drummers, but musicians who love how you played and what you've conveyed through your playing. So I'm thanking you for that. I got a couple questions for you, because there's so much I want to ask you, but I don't want to take up all your time. But I just want people to know that, things changed when Jabo started playing with James as well, because you were playing with Bobby Blue Bland, right? And your record, when you played Turn On Your Love Light, that was a groundbreaking record. And we just lost Bobby, God rest his soul, right there in Memphis. What was it like playing on that record, Jabo? I mean, did you know that you were making history at that very moment?
No, I didn't know. Tell you the truth, Steve, you want to make me answer that right. I didn't know exactly. I knew what I was going to, how I was going to, no, I knew about how I was going to play. But you can relate back to the Holiness Church or the AOH Church. And you can relate to what was going on when I started playing in that solo. I don't know. I knew that I was hearing, what I was hearing was that same beat that I was playing and what I had been doing, but it was from one of those churches, that rhythm that those churches were having, that I could hear that into that tune. And so I put what I knew to do, the way I wanted to do it, into that. That was the only way I can explain it to you.
Wow, that's amazing. That is amazing. You know, that's incredible insight right there on that whole situation. That's fantastic. You know, the late, great Levon Helm, he told me that he happened to be next door when you guys were cutting, and he came in the room right when y'all cut that track, which is unbelievable. And he said it was breathtaking. Clyde, I got something for you. Now, when you played on the Sex Machine album, the live album, Giving Up, Tear It Loose, with you and Bootsy, I mean, obviously, Bernard Odom was a great bass player, everything, but then the switch to Bootsy, things took a different, it kind of kicked up even more of a notch. Am I correct?
You're asking something that truly, I never knew what I was playing. I don't read music. I never took lessons, and I don't teach. But when I do show someone something, it's just out of the blue because I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know nothing about notes, reading music. I tell people that, and they don't believe me. And it's the truth. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just sitting playing my soul, my feeling, and my inner side. That's all I'm playing. And I try to match it up with the music that I'm involved with.
Well, that performance of Give It Up and Turn It Loose is another groundbreaking performance. And it was just an incredible feeling. It's something that everybody focused on. And the two of you guys playing together, that was unbelievable.
Well, I didn't know the song. It's just he might come on and go. I might just start going. I might just start off something, and he come in with all the rhythm section and make a song. And I go, wow, okay, cool. I don't know what I done. I just played. I don't know the bars. I don't know the turnarounds and nothing. And I feel it all and put that in the song with him. That's all I done. James Brown made songs from Jabos and our drum patterns. A lot of times he come in the studios, didn't have nothing prepared. And when we played, he made the song from our drum pattern. So we made most of the songs with Brown, but we didn't get the credits for it. And I was excited, but it was a shame the way we got treated for us. Musicians performing.
Yeah.
Well, Steve's wanting to know too about when you did the show at the Boston Gardens the day after Martin Luther King was shot. You know, there's a film out now, the night James Brown saved Boston.
Right.
Do you remember that night? And
yes.
Was that a special night for you, or
you know, if you had any feelings when Dr. King was killed? You did have those feelings, you know, but I have to say this, being a musician, when we went on stage, everything had to take a rest because we were doing it. We had to do a show. You're so accustomed to doing what you have to do. And we did the show, but afterwards, that's when I really felt it and got nervous after we headed back to the city. I was just nervous, and it really hurt. And I did a little bit of shedding a tear or two because it was really hurting. But it only when I got finished the show, I never thought about it, anybody rioting or anything, even when they were storming the stage and all coming up there. I never thought about anything but doing what I had to do, and that's to play the music. But afterwards, that's when it hit. That's when it really hit on our way back to New York City. And it was, that's the best way I can explain it. Because we did play it, and you played the show like it was, you were playing just another show. But
well,
I could feel, I felt the difference in it, yes.
One of the things was shocking was when we were coming into, it was Memphis or Atlanta, one of the two. And that's when we got the information that we're going to Boston. And as we go, wow, we're supposed to be playing here in this city, but they put us on a plane and sent us there.
You went to Boston?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
And we didn't even know we were going until we heard over, we were riding the bus then, they say, you all going to Boston. We go, wow, what are we doing here? And it was great, though.
I know I've watched that DVD many, many times, and mm-hmm. there's, as Steve mentioned, there's so much in it, you can watch it 1,000 times and get something different I can every time I watch it. But you got to give it to James Brown that night, too, and for what he did and the way he handled that crowd. And it just, I mean, it's just amazing. It's just amazing to watch it.
Well, yeah, he that's when he told people were running up on stage. That's when he told the police, all the security, don't worry about them. Let them come up.
Yeah. And he handled it.
Yeah,
but he took care of it. You know, it was real diplomatic about it, too. I mean, it was a tense moment. I mean, the time was, it was tense. But you have to give it credit. He stopped it, really.
Nobody knew what was really going to happen.
No.
But the way James Brown handled that was just amazing.
But they
And then the other amazing part of that DVD, and the other reason I watch it many times, is for you two guys. I like hearing those drums on there.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was an extraordinary performance under a very extraordinary circumstance. Dances, and it was amazing. Anyway, I'm going to let you guys go. I loved you both so much. Like I said, I could stay on this phone all night, but I don't want to hog the show. So, continued success. I hope to see you soon, and God bless you.
Thanks, bless him.
Thank you.
Hope to see you soon, Steve.
Thank you kindly.
Thanks, Steve.
And you're a great man yourself, brother.
And they like you, Steve. Okay, wow, that was Steve Jordan on the phone. We don't normally take phone calls, but Steve called me, and he had called earlier and asked to do that because he is such a fan of you guys and wanted to get a personal word into you. So I thank you for taking the time for Steve. And,
good. Yeah.
And all. Is there any particular beat or anything?
That's one thing I was getting ready to say, that when we went on the stage with Brown, we always played the same way. We didn't put nothing different in our playing because Brown wouldn't allow it. He would fine you like this if you done something different. No, when we walk on that stage, we play identically as we did last night. And Jabo taught me a lot of that too. See, Jabo's a great drummer, and I learned a lot from him.
I didn't know all of that.
Well, I learned a lot from you mentally and playing drums. So,
well, we can play a little bit of that if you want to.
Okay.
Well, do it. Don't be looking at me. Got that.
Oh, I love that. And I know you just mentioned, Clyde, how you played the, you know, you knew what to do and you tried to play it the same.
I felt that.
You felt it.
That pattern. I don't know. What's that?
Yeah, I just tell him what you did.
I don't know what I done. I just played what I felt.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm honest with you. I tell people those things, like I said, and they don't believe me. Yeah. But I don't know what I'm doing. I just play drums.
I told you that too. Wipe your nose.
Huh?
Wipe your nose. Okay. I told you you didn't know what you were doing. I told you that. Well, I did. I don't know what he's doing either.
It's amazing. Because I never read music or studied music or anything. I just play what I feel.
Well, there's a lot of music in you.
Can I say something else about that?
Yes.
You know, we all have a gift. And he, like he tells you, he can't tell you, because that used to be my question to Clyde, how did you do that? I don't know. And quit asking me. So
right.
I do it. But you know, seriously, on a serious note, he has a gift to play what he plays. He can't tell you what it is. He can play it. He can't hardly show you, but he can play it. and you can watch him. But that's just a gift that Clyde has, you know.
My inner soul.
And I tell you what, though, it's that inner feeling that he has, what's in him. He's explaining it through his drums.
I'll put it that way.
Yeah.
I'll take it.
Yeah. Put one like this here. Say, now I don't know what my inner soul gonna tell me, but I got a feel for this.
What he was doing, the way he was playing it, I hear it the way that I just played it.
I hear it the way he was playing it and play that off of that.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, that works.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, and talking about cues and that Boston show that night, and I'm pretty sure that's the one because I've watched you guys a lot on DVDs and everywhere, but there's one, and I believe it's that concert that night. The band is playing along in the middle of tune, and I mean, everybody's hitting, everybody's popping just wide open, and then just, it doesn't seem like it's at the end of a phrase or for no particular reason, all of a sudden, the whole band just, pop, 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 they just like that.
Okay.
And I was watching my wife, and she didn't, I said, wait a minute, huh? I said, wait a minute, let me run that back. And I ran that back. And you can watch James Brown. He just barely wiggles his little finger. And I said, I think that was the cue and the whole band, but not just some of the people, but everybody, boom, came right down.
You saw the wrong finger. You said little finger. But you know what he did is, that's one of the reasons you had to pay attention. When that band was cooking like that, he turned around. You saw him drop his hand like that. He dropped one finger and it pointed it down. And when he went down with it, you went down with it.
Okay. Right.
That's because you're paying attention. And that was a cue.
Okay.
That's paying attention to Brown, James Brown.
Yeah. You had to, from the time he walked on there. And when you say you saw that, see, I want to tell you this. Yeah. Say, you said little finger. No, it was this finger.
Okay.
And what you see, he had it, when he be done, he had it like so. And when you look at him, when he dropped it like that, it all cuts right there.
Well, it reminds me, I've had the question, you know, people, and you hear this, a lot of drummers get this question, like, well, when you're playing on stage, who do you lock in with? Do you listen to the bass player? Do you lock in with the bass player? Or do you lock in with a guitar player? I would always tell them, I lock in with the boss, whoever the boss is.
Actually, we're leading. Jabo and I are leading.
That's what you do. You lock in with James Brown because he controls everything in front, and that's what you're supposed to do. He is the man in front. You watch him. I don't care what you do over here. If you go with him, then you're right, you know.
And the rhythm section is putting their grooves without drum pattern. So we're leading, actually, the song, making the song. They just put in what they feel to make us play with Brown.
Okay, we got a question. This is for you, Clyde.
Yes.
Best of luck to you, Clyde, but this is from Zoltan from Hungary. And he wants to know, how did you develop that ghost note, the ghost note bass grooves? Like he's saying, for example, the break to Soul Pride.
That's going again to know what I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know how I developed that. It was a pattern that I would just play. And I'd add that because Brown would give me a signal to play that ghost note. So it wasn't something that I knew what was going to happen. A lot of times we didn't know what was going to happen. We just play what Brown wiggled his finger or butt about, you know. We just play. And we were followed by James Brown and the rhythm section. We were, Jabo and I was always in lead. But once again, I can tell you, I don't know what I was doing or how I done it. I just did it with a feeling.
Very good. Well, I've just got another, I guess this is a personal comment or question. You know, when I hear you guys on record or on film, you sound very, very strong, very tight, very perfect, you know, is the best word really to describe how you sound. But now I see a drummer's play, and now everybody wants to talk about how hard they hit, how powerful they are. I'm the hardest hitting drummer in the world. Mm-hmm. I break sticks. I break cymbals. I've got to be the best drummer in the world because I play so loud. I play so loud and so hard. And every time I hear that, I keep thinking back about, well, you know, those two guys at James Brown, they must not have been any good because they were playing down here.
Well, see, I have a lot of people try to get my snare sound. And I just tune my snare to my ears the way I wanted to hear it. So it's like they try to get that snare sound, but they can't because they don't know what I'm doing.
But you got the snare sound.
Right.
And Jabo, you got the sound is what I'm saying. You got the sound, but you didn't get it from here.
I understand. No. You know, that's a waste of energy. I do not flag. I'm lazy. I like to have everything right here, and I play that way. But, you know, to play... You give volume when volume is needed, but you, what's the word? You are a drummer, mm-hmm. and a drummer is the heartbeat of any band.
Correct.
And what your job is to sit down in a pocket and lock in with the rhythm section so you can drive whoever's in front of you.
Right.
You are a pumper. You are the heartbeat that pumps the energy to everybody in front of you or with you. It is not how loud you can play, because who cares about how loud you play? Because if you're playing that loud, you may be trying to hide something.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to play that loud to groove, man. And most of the guys think it's not about you. It's about the band and people that's in front of you. It's how well can you sit down and groove with the people you're playing with.
Right.
Because, for example, I'm going back to where some of the young people don't really understand or listen to. Listen to Count Basie's rhythm section and see what a close-knit rhythm section sounds like. And then you come back to a James Brown rhythm section. It was not a lot of drawing back. If you drew back, he's gone and left you two or three balls ahead. You done got fined because you done lost it.
That's what
it's all right here, man. And
that's
you
what
just
he always tell you. Do it now, tomorrow's too late.
Yeah, you know, you have to pay attention to what you're doing. And you are, like I still say, you're the heartbeat. So you sit there and you sit in the pocket with that band and you groove.
Yeah.
A lot of people forget that. They don't understand. That's the same way as listening to your music.
Right.
My music is for my ears. I'm playing so I can hear what's going on. Not that I don't care what you hear, but I'm trying to hear what I'm doing.
Well, was James Brown always happy with on stage volume? I mean, did he ever ask you to play less or play more?
No. It's not the idea of playing. No. He never did tell you about volume. What he wanted to hear, he stressed hearing the one, as they call it.
Mm-hmm.
One, two, three, four, one.
Gotta do the one.
He stressed hearing that, but you didn't have to play loud to get that one.
No. Nope.
Because I don't consider myself a loud drummer. But you hear everything I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
But you sit there and you write up on it. There was a young man that's here asking me when I saw you, Clyde, or y'all, you sitting right there over it. Yeah. I don't have time to go over here when he's up there. Right. I got everything right in here where I can do it with.
Well, and that's I did a recording doing. Last week with a guy that's got a band, he says, now he's telling me, he says, I want a James Brown beat. His drummer was good, but he says, I want a James Brown beat in this song. I says, okay. I went there and done the song with him, but I changed up the head of it. I says, you're holding this too long, and it don't mean nothing. So cut all that out. Let's go with the drums, bass, and then you come in.
Yeah.
See, but when you hold something too long, it don't make no sense. Now, the only thing, the funky drummer, he made me hold that without any help, you know, and I didn't like it at all. But I done it. So,
well, there's another story to Funky Drummer, too. I mean,
could be.
Well, I'm talking about, how did you start doing the Funky Drummer? Was that, were you all refreshed and rested? And because that's a Funky Drummer.
Well, we had just got into Cincinnati. We were tired. We wanted to go to the hotel and go to sleep off the bus. And Brown came in the bus, walked up the bus steps and said, hey, we're going to the studio and start recording right now. And we go, right now, we want to rest. No, we went to the studio instantly.
Straight.
And I went in and set up drums and just started playing that pattern. And the bass player and guitar player came in, and Brown walked in the door and added some lyrics to it. A lot of times you don't know what Brown is saying because he don't know what he said. He's just adding lyrics.
I noticed another thing you said when you came into the My Cymbal studio today and you see your kit here. You looked at those tom-toms, the two rack toms and the floor tom, and you said, well, we don't really hit those that much.
No.
No, you do that bass drum, snare drum, and hi-hat.
Right. Well, see, when we play the drums, we usually play... James Brown! And then you go. But that was the only one we usually used. We never used those too high up there. So it was just use that for that part and go into the song, and we snare and hi-hat.
Yeah, but you wore that hi-hat and that snare drum and bass drum out.
Well, I had to. Get fined. Seriously.
But I'm going to go back to that volume thing for just another minute, because like I said, it's kind of a personal thing with me. You know, I get a lot of advice from a lot of band members and all about volume. And, you know, David Garibaldi is a friend of mine, the Tower of Power. We were talking about him earlier, and I know he really is a huge fan of both of you guys. And he plays those ghost notes so beautifully, too. And you think about him. I mean, that's a big band, too. I mean, all those horns and everything. But he's playing down there and playing that hi-hat and playing that snare drum. So he's got something cooking, Jabo. I mean, yeah.
But you know, Jim, it's just back to what we just said. It's not how loud you play. It's how well you play with the rhythm section. How well you blend with that rhythm section.
Correct.
And you hear him playing, man. He's making the hits that he has to do. He's doing all of the stuff he has to do. But then again, you don't have to be, it's not overbearing. It's blending.
Well, Jabo, I don't take how we blend with the rhythm section. The rhythm section blend with us.
Well, everybody has to be on the same accord.
Same accord,
and the same
but we started out.
Yeah,
we're the beginning of it.
Understandable, but I'm just saying you still have to be able to gel with each other.
Right, you got to be able to come in and play with our pattern. And that's the whole thing. See, the rhythm section always played with our pattern. We didn't play with their pattern. We didn't play with nothing the rhythm section thought of.
Okay.
Yeah. Here's Matt Danko from Austin, Texas. He says, greetings from Austin, Texas. And we've talked about James Brown being a strict taskmaster. He said, master, was it ever stressful working with him live or in the studio? I mean,
it goes back, Jim, to the gentleman in Texas. It goes back to one thing. Who is the boss? He tells you what he wants from you. He asks you to do that. You do what he asks you to do, and then you leave it on. It's not stressful. Because if you feel like you can't do it, then you know you're man enough to say, well, I don't think I can do that.
Then he don't want you there.
And then again, you know, if you give it a good try, if you sit down and he tell you what you want to do, because he's done that to me. He told me, said, well, hey, I hear you playing, but I want you to play it like, and then let me show you. Or sometimes I say, hey, you show. Then he'll get up and he'll sit there. Now, I don't know what he's doing, what he called himself doing, but I'll sit there and look at him, and when he finishes, I'll go back and play what I was already playing before he said anything, and he'll look at me and say, that's it.
When Brown...
You understand what I'm saying? That's what it is. But then again, he thought it was his idea to tell you how to play that tune or how you want, but you still playing what you play. And he looked at you and said, "Yeah, you." He said, "He couldn't play. He just couldn't play.
Bad.
He couldn't play drums."
And I'm going, "Jabo won't be sounding like that." I go, "What he's asking for? Jabo don't do that kind of stuff."
But what he already asked is what I was already playing. And he came down and said he's going to show me how to play it. Uh-huh. And I just sit there and look at him. And when he finishes, I get back down there
and play
what I was already playing.
Right.
That's it.
So
there you go. But he's the boss. You know? So, hey, right. Make him feel like that. That's good.
We got a comment here. This is from April Singer. She simply says, "You two bring tears to my eyes." So
that's you know the accolades that you get from people. It's so wonderful to know that you've been doing something or you're doing something to give to somebody that's appreciative of what you're doing.
Really,
you know, it's a good thing. Even the other drummers around that walk up and say, "Well, man, you guys inspired." That make you feel good because it shows that you have done something or you're doing something that they appreciate from you, you know.
Absolutely. Here's Mark Horn from Las Vegas, Nevada. What song from James Brown does Clyde and Jabo think best exemplifies their drumming? I mean, what are some of the tunes?
Everything.
Right.
Just everything. Well, I agree with that. I wouldn't know how to answer that either.
Nothing you could miss. I make a mistake because I say you get this.
But it was, you know, everything that you were doing, even though it was a different way of doing it, you just enjoyed doing everything. Because basically, like back to what Clyde may have said, you were doing you. That's what you were doing. You were doing you, and you kind of pleased with, I never get pleased with what I'm doing, but I can improve a little. Sometime, you know.
One of the tunes that comes to my mind is "I Got That Feeling," you know. And what do you remember how that came about?
That was a drum part I just thought of. Here you go. I got the feeling.
You're gonna do the hair. I wake up.
That's when you go to baby. Oh, baby. Oh, baby. Oh, baby. Oh, baby.
Yeah.
It wasn't something that he showed us. We just put that in there when he said baby pang. I put that in there and the whole rhythm section put it in. And then we go to the turnaround and come back to that groove again. And that groove was something I started out because that's what I felt for singing that song.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. That was before click tracks and Pro Tools fancy stuff, huh?
No.
Click tracks. No way. Ain't no
that's
way.
That's your seat.
Okay.
Wait,
no way. Jabo and I would not like a click track, even a thing in the studio, a timer, or the click, click, click.
They ask you that. They ask you, we want you to hear the click. Don't do that
no
to me
sir.
Because, see, you cannot play with a click. I play from in here. I play with feeling. I have learned the hard way. When you say time, play time. I can play time. Now, you're human. You may falter. You may drop or pick up every now and then. But how are you gonna pick it up if you out there don't know what I'm doing? Right. But don't tell me about a click crack because I think that's a crutch and I don't like crutches.
I go in the studio now to record and they go, "Do you want the clicker?" I go, "No way, ain't no way. That thing is too perfect." 100% perfect.
And you're only human.
Right.
But you hold that, you hold a tempo to the best of your ability. You're not going to always be exactly on that same.
And all you're thinking about is that clicker. No. You ain't thinking about nothing, no groove or nothing.
There you be.
You're thinking about that clicker. Mm-mm. And I said, no, I don't want no clicker. What I'm going to do with a clicker? I'm going to make my own time.
Okay.
Okay, I agree with that. And Jabo said it too, and you're playing with humans too. You're human and you're playing with humans, so why you want a machine in the middle of that?
Because it's one thing about it, Jeff. You tell me where you want that tune.
Right.
And I'm going to lock that where what I hear you doing, I'm going to lock it in because right. I was playing with a group since we got a minute or two. I was playing with a group, and you know where I'm going. And I said, while you're playing, you may start here. But for you, so wait, I hear you up here. Mm-hmm. Now, wait a minute. Do you want me to play where you kick that tune off, or do you want me to follow you up the line? No. Play where we started. I'll come back to you. And then I told the guitar player, you don't play drums, you play guitar. So don't tell me how to play.
Okay. From beginning of that time signal, you play it to the end.
Yeah.
The same signal.
And that's what you do. If you take the time and want to go up there, if that's what you want me to do, I'll follow you. But if you tell me one place, I'm going to stay there till you come back to me. Because I still say this about drummers. You can make them come back to you.
It's harder to do. It's harder to play that way for me.
Well, I'm just saying, if you're playing and they want to ease up on, if that you can hear them trying to ease that time up, if you sit here and put that backbeat on them and bring them back, they'll have to come right. They got to come back to you or look like they're lost out there by themselves.
The only time sometimes that we would pick up the song is when we'd be playing a song and Brown would go,
He wants to, take it up. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Normally you follow what he wants you to do.
Normally it's not that fast, but at that time he wanted fast, so you pick it up there.
Yeah, and when you were, I just also want to point out, when you were doing, you talked about the one, he wanted that one. When you were doing that, I got the feeling a while ago, I noticed that hi-hat coming back down on that one, man. There was no question where one was. You'd put that hi-hat, you'd open it up and bring it back down on one. And I don't know if you knew you were doing that or not.
No, I don't.
But boy, I could sure hear a one on that.
It's been instilled, so.
It's what I feel.
You play the one. You automatically play it. Now, you don't have to play it, you know, just whap.
Right.
But when you plan it, if they're listening, you hear it.
Yeah.
You know, okay, yeah.
Yeah, it's, I don't know. I know it's 1, 2, 3, 4 sometimes. Well, that 4 sometimes is the 1. You use that, but you don't use the 2 or the 3, but that's the groove. 1, 2, 3, bang. Or you can use bang, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah.
So either way, that 1 and 4 is the one.
Yeah. Okay. I'm going to ask a favor. You know, one of the issues, problems I have in hosting these wonderful shows is I can't pronounce all these cities all over the world. So I'm lucky today that I have Norbert here with Meinl Cymbals from Germany, and he's going to come over to the microphone, and he's going to pronounce this city. He's going to pronounce the city name. And read this question.
See this?
Which one?
Yeah, this one.
See this?
Yeah.
Oh.
No. Yeah. You see this, don't you?
Okay, here is a question from Michael Zagon aus Osnabrück in Deutschland.
Wait a minute, let me try that. No, what? No.
I actually know who this guy is.
Oh.
Michael Zagon from Osnabrück in Germany asks, both drummer had a big influence on my drumming, thanks to Clyde and Jabo, and of course everyone at Memphis Drum Shop. Greetings from Germany, Michael. Very nice.
Oh. Cool. Thank you, Norbert. You did a much better job than I could with How do you think you could do on that, Jabo?
See, the only thing that James Brown would tell Jabo and I, if the song is too fast or the song is too slow, that's the only thing he would tell us. I want it faster or slow it down. But far as showing us how to play it, no way.
Let me ask you a question. What was that he just asked from Germany?
He didn't really ask the question. He just said that both of you had a big influence on him and just appreciated you being here today.
Oh,
and just,
okay.
And again, he's sitting in Germany and he's being allowed to listen and watch you guys play, and he appreciates that
as
we all do.
Yes, appreciate you a lot.
He's that's, not here today, but he's still listening to you live and watching you. And he just says thanks for that and thanks for what you've done.
And I still didn't know what I was doing.
Well, we're getting close to the end of the show here. We got just a little bit more to go. This is Connor Vandegrift from Los Angeles, California. And this is to both Clyde and Jabo. What is one piece of advice you could give to the drummers of today or the future?
Pay attention. And that's number one. Pay attention.
The other thing is to learn the tunes and learn how to be a rhythm player. Learn how to sit in a pocket with a group. Learn how to be the drummer, be the heartbeat for the group that you're playing with. It's not how much you play or how less you play. It's how well you play with the people that you're playing with.
That's right.
You know, you got to pay attention. You have to pay attention and play within the group.
Okay.
See, one of my things right now, I watch people in the audience when we playing a tune down. When I play with bands, I watch people in the audience. I see how they move, and I add on to stuff. You said it's like, I say, these people are grooving, so now I'm going to give them something to groove off of. And I use a lick to put in that one and four to make them groove better. So.
And I've got a question. We've had several questions around this theme, but it's about the snare drum. And it's about the snare drum sound. And I know when I listen to you guys play, and again, I go back to that the night James Brown saved Boston, and boy, that snare drum sound just really stands out, and you can hear it so clearly. And I think that was a metal snare drum. And what did you guys really change up between wood and metal snare drums? Or, I mean, I know, you know, a long time ago, all the snare drums were wood. And probably the first snare drum all of us had was a wooden snare drum. And then did you change to metal later on? And was there a reason you went to a metal snare drum?
Well, I play the metal snare, and I like to say, if you start playing, that's what you're playing anyway. And I found out when you play a wood snare, you don't get that wood hold the sound tone in. It does not ring.
Correct.
As much as a metal snare. Now you can get a set of drums with metal hoops, as we're playing right here with these metal hoops on it, and you hear the difference. You can put wood hoops on here, and you have a dampened sound. And sometimes if you're playing auditoriums or stadiums or playing out with a band, a metal snare sometimes will give you that. But now they're miking everything, so you can still tighten your snare the way you like it and still get that same pop.
But I don't like metal snares. They give you too much of a ring. It's a ring in them. Bring, when you hit it, pop, ring. But that pop is a ring. Bring, I'm going, I don't like that.
But you can stop that. You can stop that ring.
Well, I stop it with wood. And you know, a wood drum. Because I just tighten the bottom and top for what the sound I want. And when up here, when I'm playing today with different groups, I use a strip of tape on each one of those drums to cut out the hum. I don't like the hum in drums.
Another question we had, several people wanted to know this. What's the funniest thing James Brown ever said to you on stage?
Man.
was there anything that ever made you just almost lose it? Or
we never have been introduced.
Now, you know, I can't say that. Man, you're thinking about so many years with so many things happening on stage. But I never will forget playing, and he missed a cue. He missed one that you've been doing almost every night. You catch it, and he just come back there. He's coming back there where you are. He's coming back close and turn around and look at you and say, ha ha. And you got me, didn't you? And he just laughed, and you laughed because you know you got me. But he's coming back to do it again. But that's about the most, that's the funniest thing, because it was always, it's strictly like business up there, man. It wasn't a whole lot of time that he's going to say something that you're going to crack up on, you know.
Yeah, looked like you were pretty much all business.
That's the name of the game. You're business, You're enjoying what you're doing, but the name, you business, because you're entertaining people that's done paid money to hear you. And you're entertaining them, and you're doing the best you can, but you're having as much fun as they are if you like what you're doing.
Good.
And sometime before we go on a show, a different type show, he tells you, the leader or whatever, what we're going to do, what he's going to do. And he might go into... He tells you he's going to go with his arms like that, and you're on that lick with him right there, and then you go into the next song, which he tell you, this is what I'm going to sing. Okay, but he don't do nothing without you knowing what he's going to do. But that's again, why you have to pay attention.
But then again, if he tells you he's going to do some things in that show, you look for something else. Because a lot of times he's going to forget what he told you right. And do something else. That's where you just pay attention to it.
Right.
Ain't no big deal. Let's just
go with the show.
Just go with him. Watch him.
Yeah.
That's it.
This is for Jabo, and you may know him. He says it's Bob from Mobile.
Who?
Bob from Mobile, Alabama.
No, what was the name?
Bob.
Oh, Bob. Okay.
He just says, as I've told you before, your style of drumming was the biggest influence on my playing of all the styles I have studied throughout my life. And his question again goes back to the grace notes. And how did you and Clyde come up with the use of grace notes between the backbeats?
To tell you the truth, Bob, I do not even know. That's the way I play, and I play that way. And I think a lot of the grace notes that were played from even playing the shuffle. And then you go into just a regular other tune, and you do it. It's just, I don't know, it's just something that
that's
you do.
That's a feeling.
It's something that you do. You know, that's the best way I can explain that.
You put that there for a tone sound for yourself. But ghost notes is like, I don't know what you're talking about. You know, because it's something I just throw in there. Myself and Jabo taught me a lot of that. Throw in there yourself for the feeling. You know, but there's nothing, you know, they don't even write ghost notes in real music.
I don't think you can. He said ghost. That means that's not seeable.
You can't see it.
Yeah.
Hey, here's a question from Richard Ducat from Vero Beach, Florida. And he says, you two guys have helped shape the way I play drums to this very day. And do you still find yourselves learning more about drums?
Every day. Every time you play. Now, this is for me. I can't speak for Clyde. I speak for me. I play 5 nights a week. Right now. But every time I play, I always hear something else that I can put in to what we're doing. And I always hear it. Mm-hmm. I can always hear it. And I know each day I'm adding a little something because if I'm listening, if I'm listening to somebody else play, I hear something. Oh, yeah, okay. I'm going to incorporate that into what I'm doing, you know?
Well, I play with other groups at home in different places. I don't play with the same group all the time. I just play what they're doing and add my ghost notes in there. And it may be anywhere, but that's my feeling. And they don't even use those when they have a regular drummer. That drummer just play straight with them. But when I play, I add all that stuff that is not there.
That's why they call Clyde.
Okay.
Yeah, they call the funky drummer. Gentlemen,
but I love it.
Gentlemen, I want to just say, it's been a real just pleasure. Everybody in the studio today has just had the best time, and I want to thank you so much for being here today. It's been a wonderful event, and I want to again
thank you for the joy of even being here, Jim. It has been a true pleasure, man.
Well,
yesterday, and I meant that, man. I am so in awe of what you have here, and your spirit is so pure and so clean. I thank you for that, man.
Thank you.
And out of the blue, try Yamaha and Mino cymbals. You know, it's not something that just try. These are great sound. They got the best sound in drums, we think. Yamaha and Mino cymbals. Try those. Well,
but you can only do that at mycymbal.com.
There you go.
I'd have been told you.
Hey, all right. Thank you so much. And I totally agree with you, too, both of you, and glad what you said. And we definitely want to throw a big shout out to Meinl Cymbals for bringing you here today. And they've been, Meinl Cymbals are just incredible.
Well, I'm not saying that just because they brought us here.
I know.
I play them.
I know. And it's the people at Meinl as well for me.
Yes, right. That's it. That's what make it. Thank
you. The instrument and the people. So we want to give them a big thanks too.
Thank you.
So we're about to trail out here. Could you guys just give us a little play out? We're going to pretend like James Brown is about to leave the stage.
Oh Lord!
You pick something.
I got the 1, 2, 3.
Meinl Cymbals.
We have to have somebody up front doing all that stuff for us to follow them together.
Thank you so much for it all.
Thank you.
Meinl Cymbals.
We love you.
Meinl Cymbals and mycymbal.com. Thank you.
That's it.
've said, you know, more than once, you know, remember this, the cymbal is bigger than all of us.
I think the drums have somehow hogged a lot of the name credit. We're as much or more cymbal players than we are drummers.
I'm a cymbal freak, I'm a cymbalholic, if there's such a word. It's quite neat, isn't it? Cymbalholic.
Cymbals are arguably the most personal part of your setup.
When you're buying your cymbals, you're buying something that you can't change.
With drums, you can do a lot of things. You can tune them, you can muffle them, you know. With cymbals, you can't, you basically, that's what you have, you know.
The cymbals are your color instruments.
The cymbal is really the instrument that carries the rhythm. You know, the subdivisions are really there.
You could do a blindfold test of Art Blakey, Elvin Jones, Max Roach, Philly Joe Jones, Papa Joe Jones, Sid Catlett, whoever you want to put up there. Their ride cymbal was their calling card. You could identify the drummer from their ride cymbal sound.
That's why you see, you know, John Riley, for example, rolled in yesterday with his cymbal bag. He wanted to have his own cymbals.
Most of your business is on that cymbal. So that kind of becomes a signature of your sound.
Drums. First name, cymbals, last name.
Mycymbal.com is a fantastic idea.
Mycymbal.com is probably one of the most innovative websites that's out there today.
The new way for consumers to purchase product.
I think that's the way it should be done, really. It's amazing.
You actually get a really unique experience.
A new and different way to buy cymbals.
It's the type of information that you want to get from a retail store when you walk in the door and talk with a guy one-on-one, and he's got it online, so that and you can get it 24 hours a day. It's brilliant. It's brilliant.
A drummer can virtually go without getting out of his pajamas and check it out online.
It allows the customer or potential customer to actually hear and see the symbol they're buying without having to travel miles and miles and miles to the store and try it out there.
It's an incredible tool for a drummer to be able to go on a website and actually hear the symbol that they're going to buy. I mean, actually the actual symbol.
You buy that exact symbol. You hear it played and you can buy that exact symbol.
The symbol that's played is the one that you purchase.
Well, every symbol has a serial number appointed to it. So it's not that you like a 21-inch raw bell dry rod, you're going to get the first one out of the box. You're going to get the one that you heard online because of the way they set everything up.
To actually hear what a symbol sounds like and you get exactly that symbol that that guy played, that's amazing. It's great.
MySymbol.com takes a lot of the guesswork out of it.
By filming each model, by filming each unit individually, they're really helping drummers make a confident decision about buying a cymbal online, which is typically a risky business.
The risk is taken out of it because you're actually hearing people play the cymbal beforehand, and the people that he's got playing the cymbals know how to play the cymbals they're playing.
The cymbals are played by the professional players, first of all. And we are recommending good cymbals. It's not just to sell a cymbal or anything like that. It's really recommending a good sounding cymbal.
When Stanton Moore comes to town, he puts them to work playing the cymbals, and that's the cymbal you'll buy.
They get to hear the cymbal played by a professional or by somebody who really knows how to pull out the very specific and individual sounds of that cymbal, or possibly play in a style that reflects the design of the cymbal, and really hear the cymbal in under the best possible circumstances, you know, well recorded.
And with the quality of digital sound and recording now, man, you know, it's the next thing to be in there.
This kind of thing should have been going on 20 years ago.
This is the 21st century. I'm finally appreciating that there are some people that have realized that it is the 21st century.
There is no other drum retail outlet online that is doing what they are doing as far as bringing the cymbals to the forefront.
To my knowledge, he has everything that everybody makes. You're never going to find that kind of selection offline. And not only does he have sound files, which other people have done, he has video files, high def video and audio. You can do everything but touch the cymbal.
Can't get any better in terms of finding the breadth of selection to choose a cymbal that would define your